Hey everyone, and welcome back to the Engineering Toolbox channel. So I want to continue on talking about control charting. Up until this point, we've been working with eye charts and MR charts. And we went through and we set up all these crazy formulas and we made all this conditional formatting so that our chart dynamically updates. So if you haven't seen up to this point, I definitely recommend that you go all the way back to the beginning of this playlist. You'll find how to create this chart. Now this chart dynamically updates and formats as we add data to this table. That's all great and everything, but as you probably already know, there are other types of control charts aside from eye charts and MR charts. Now, another very common one is actually the XbarR chart and the range chart. And I would say this is one of the most common, if not the most common method for control charting. It tends to be very robust and it just lends itself well to a lot of sampling protocols and that type of thing for manufacturing. But I don't want to get into the theory or kind of the foundations of control charting in this. I'm going to work off the assumption that you already know what an XbarR chart is and how to do it. I'm just going to be showing you how to set up the data table so that you can add data to the table and it'll dynamically update this chart, or these charts, I should say, as data is added, and it'll conditionally format it just like we did with the IMR chart. Now, since XbarR charts have subgroup data, things get a little bit trickier, and I'm going to show you what I think is the best and most robust way to set up these charts in that dynamic fashion that I was talking about. So with that, let's dive in. So how do we set this up? There's really two kind of fundamental ways that we could start this off, and one I would say is slightly simpler and maybe more easy to set up and just get going. But the other one I think is a lot more robust, and that's what I'm going to focus on. So there's two kind of ways that the data might be arranged, or the data that you're working with might be arranged, or that you could arrange it if it's not already arranged. One way is kind of this matrix format, I would call it. You have the group. So in this case, I'm grouping by the date that the sample was taken on, or the samples were taken on. So we have five samples taken on this date, then five samples taken on this date, and then so on down the line. And what we could do is we could just say, well, our XbarR value is just the average of these five data points. And then we could go on and continue on doing all of our columns just like we did for the IMR chart. But I think a lot of times, especially if you're maybe extracting data from an ERP system or any other kind of system, or maybe like a quality inspection system, your data might be arranged like this, or actually there's a pretty good chance that your data is arranged like this. So this is kind of maybe the more robust solution, or maybe the easier solution, depending on how you're getting your data. The limitation to this is that we have a fixed number of columns. If you know that your sample size is always going to be five data points per group, maybe this isn't such a bad solution for you, but depending on the situation, your number of samples could change. You might have a situation where you're not going to get the same number of data points for each sample. So that's not ideal, but you might run into that scenario. And I'll remind you that the goal with all these documents and what I'm trying to demonstrate with these videos is how to set up Excel templates that can be used for as broad a range of scenarios as possible. So I'm going to work off the assumption that we're going to arrange our data like this. And I think it'll all become clear why by the time we get done with this video. Now, it may seem odd to some of you, but I promise this will work out, and I think it actually ends up being pretty darn easy once we get into it. Now, I just want to remind you that these groups don't have to be dates. I'm choosing to use dates in this case, but they don't have to be dates. You could have this as group one. It could be group one like that. It could be cavity one if you're working with multiple cavities in a die or something like that. You can name these whatever you want and this will still work. These do not have to be dates. I just want to reiterate that point. All right, so how do we do this, or where do we go from here? It'd be pretty hard to set this up so that if we had like an XbarR column in this column here, it'd be pretty hard to say like average of these 5 points, and then like how would that work? Well, that doesn't work with a table. So what we have to do is actually come up with a way to subgroup this. So as of Excel 2016, they added a feature called Power Query, and that feature is going to make this really easy for us to kind of aggregate by a group name like we have here. So we can convert what currently is like this list data into subgroup data that will be very easy to work off of. All right, so that's enough explanation. Let's just see how we do this. So if we go to the data tab, we can see some interesting kind of buttons or features here that Excel has. And there's this group called Get and Transform Data. And this is kind of referring to some of the features of Power Query, and it's really kind of hidden. And I don't know if a lot of people know about this feature in Excel, but it's very powerful. And I would say it's one of my new favorite things about Excel that I've really been trying to use a lot more lately because it is so powerful. What we can do is we can select our table here with our data in it, and then we just say from table and range. I know that's really ambiguous. You would never know this is here unless somebody showed you. But if we click that, it brings up this whole new window and all these new features that allow us to kind of manipulate data and that type of thing. So how we do this is we want to hit this group by button. And what this is going to do is it's going to group our data by the group. So we're going to say group by group, and then we're going to add columns from that. And we're going to first get the count of the number of rows in each group. And this will all make sense in a little bit. And then we're going to say let's call this XbarR. And we'll take the average of the I values. And then we'll take, now they don't have a range aggregate. So what we can do is take the max. Let's say X max. I don't know why I called that X bar. We already have that. So we have X bar, X max, count. I'm going to call this N, which would be the more proper way to name it. Then we're going to add an X min, which is going to be the min. And we're going to make sure we're taking the min from this I column. And really, that's all we need just for now. So watch what happens when I hit that. So we went from this data orientation, let's say, to this subgroup data orientation. And this looks a lot more like the other version of the data. Only it's already doing a lot of the calculations for us. It's just taking the data that's arranged vertically or in rows and grouping it by the group name and then doing those calculations by group. So you can see each one has a count of 5 data points in each, and this is going to be important. I'll tell you why later. And then the X bar value, so the average of each I value in each group, and then the max and the min. And what we can do is calculate the range from there and do all of our conditional formatting calculations that I showed you in the IMR conditional formatting video. Can do all those same things from here. Now, this will be an important step. Make sure to hit this drop down and say close and load to. This will give us some options where we can tell it where we want this data to load to. And we actually just want to load this data to a table so that we can do some further manipulations and set up those formulas to do all the conditional formatting and everything for us. So once we have our table, the first thing we can do is calculate the X bar bar value, or the X double bar value, also called the grand mean sometimes. All we have to do for that is take the average of our X bar values to get our X bar bar value. And then we probably want to calculate the range too, so it's going to be the X max minus the X min. And then from that we can find the R bar value, which is going to be the average of all the range values. And then the last thing that we need to calculate is the sigma value, or the short-term standard deviation, which is looked up from constant tables for control charting. And I have all the constant values for the different subgroup values here. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to look up our N value from this table, and then we're going to look up the different constants that we'll need for the X bar charts and the range charts then. So what we're going to do is we're going to add a column called sigma. And then what we're going to do is take the R bar value and divide it by the value that we look up based on this N value. So we're going to look up the N value from our constant table. And then what we need is this D2 value, which is determined again by this N value. So we're going to look up the third column in this table, and then we're going to do an exact match. And if we hit enter there, that is our sigma value based on this N value, or the subgroup size. Now, again, you'll notice that because we're calculating it based on the sample size, no matter what the sample size is, the sigma value will calculate. And this also works if we have varying sample sizes. So if I were to go back in here and delete this value, and if I go back to my table here, and then I hit this refresh button, which refreshes the Power Query, then this N recalculates to 4, and our sigma value is actually different than the other subgroup values. So that's also another nice feature of doing it this way. So I'm gonna undo that. Now we need to calculate the range chart control limits. So we'll add a column called range upper control limit and range lower control limit. For the range upper control limit, we're gonna take the R bar value and multiply that by the value that we look up from our constant table. So we'll grab the table again, And then this time we want to look in this column. So the D4 value is for the range chart upper control limit, and that's the 10th column. Do an exact match, hit enter there, and that is our range chart upper control limit. For our lower control limit, I'm just going to copy this. And instead of the 10th column, I just know it's the 9th column. So if we look at a constant table, so the D3 value is the one that we want to look up there. So now this is everything that we need to go ahead and build the control chart. I'm not going to go through how to do all the extra columns and all that kind of stuff. If you go back and look at my videos on the IMR chart, it's really the same thing. So if I just hide this, hide these two, really, you should already see that this is basically the same format as the IMR chart table was in those videos. So if you just go back and look through those videos, use the data in this one and apply those same formulas and formatting as we did in the IMR chart. So you're gonna build all these extra helper columns and use the formulas that we did here to build the rules. And then from that, you'll end up with the same end result as we had here with this conditionally formatted control chart. Hopefully you found this method of creating XbarR and R charts in Excel useful. I haven't been able to find another method that is this robust. So if you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you don't miss any of my future videos on topics like this and much more. Everything from data analysis to engineering software. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.